You love the Philadelphia Eagles? Let me get a hell yeah!
Hey, what's going on, guys? Welcome to Party on Broad. Party on Broad can be found on iTunes and Spotify. We are brought to you by The Painted Lines. Please be sure to like, comment, subscribe. Check us out on Twitter, Twitch, Facebook, Instagram, you name it. Today, we are doing a Paul Reed film breakdown. We're going to just evaluate and assess his stint with the Delaware Blue Coats, the bubble. The season didn't end as we kind of wanted it to, especially in that final game there. But what a massive success for the Blue Coats. Joining me today is my man, Justin. You know him on Twitter, at J_Persichetti. He is our Delaware Blue Coats beat reporter. What's going on, Justin?
You know, it's a good day. It's a good morning. I missed YouTube for a little bit. I did. We haven't been on here for a while, especially me and you together. So it's nice to pair up again and get some good content out there for the Painted Lines people. So we're going to be doing a film breakdown on Paul Reed and his season with the Blue Coats. So I'm really excited because I got to see all those games firsthand.
Yeah, and we have Kevin saying good morning. It's afternoon on my end. All right, but let's do this first. Before we start, you know, looking at the film and talking about Paul Reed and what we expect his impact to be with the Sixers, let's go back, because back in like March, me, Austin, and Tiago did a scouting report on Paul Reed. Here's what we had to say.
It is an interesting guy. When you think of DePaul, you don't really think of any, you know, high level athletes, high level NBA prospects. But I think Paul Reed might be able to break that trend a little bit. You're talking about the 2018-2019 most improved player in the Big East, and I think from that point on, Paul Reed's game has really translated well and it's really made some significant strides for DePaul. If you watch a lot of the Big East games, DePaul has been kind of a sneaky out, giving teams a lot of difficulties in the Big East. And you go right back to this guy. He is an absolute defensive anchor on that team. He has made significant improvements from his sophomore year to his junior year on the defensive end. He's a guy who can really go out, defend multiple positions, provide rim protection, and anchor the defense for DePaul. So the first thing that stands out when you watch him is just that sheer versatility on the defensive end and how he can impact the game on that side of the court. Now, the offense is something that I guess we maybe discuss a little bit here on this pod. It has not come with the same arc as his defense, but I think that there is some intriguing traits and intriguing development tools for him, especially if he falls in the right NBA team and in the right coaching structure. So for me, Paul Reed is a super interesting guy, a guy who I would definitely consider in the first round, and a guy who I would definitely consider ahead of some of the bigger names that you hear a lot about in the power forward, center.
Toby Tobin!
That guy. So he's a really smart, really aware off weak side defender. So he's able to feel the drive, feel where the defense is collapsing, and immediately rotates to the rim and meets the shooter at the rim. So that's something that really, it's a lot of fun to watch. The defense also plays out on the perimeter. So he has a 7'2" wingspan. And I mean, he gets on guys' face in the perimeter, makes their life absolutely hell. He moves very well laterally, I think, as well. And I think that plays out well as perhaps even a small forward type contributor. I also want to point out, like, on offense, he's not a complete zero. So there are things about his game that are very interesting. Now, he shot 33% on 103 attempts from three. Obviously, that's not going to catch anybody's eye it's not going to be something that people are going to focus on right away. But he does things off the ball, and he does things as a passer that, to me, really intrigues me. I think that when you talk about a little bit of a guy like how Miami used Bam Adebayo, he has a little bit of that ability to see cutters, see rollers, and use his vision to find guys. And I think that's something that perhaps a team in the future may want to exploit there as well. So the defensive upside is definitely off the chart. The shot needs work, but has some substance behind it. And I think there's a little bit of playmaking behind Paul Reed as well.
All right, so that was my man, Tiago. Go follow him on Twitter, at TScabby, one of the best Sixers follows, period. Let's get down to the nitty-gritty here of what we saw with Paul Reed. You look at his defensive rating, just like Tiago mentioned, the defense absolutely translated 100.2 to 88.8 to 102.6 with the Delaware Blue Coats. You love to see that. That was kind of what Tiago summed up, was his defensive versatility is really what stood out watching tape on this guy at DePaul. True shooting percentage, three-point percentage, points per 40 minutes. My goodness, this has just kind of been a rise for Paul Reed. 65.9 true shooting percentage in Delaware, 44.4% from three, and then points per 40 minutes if you look at and compare his seasons there. Just a huge increase in production. And the big revelation has to be Paul Reed's jump shot. He's been able to knock down that 44% from three despite struggling from distance in college. He's kind of got some unorthodox shooting mechanics, but he's got great touch around the basket. He's got some creativity there, like Tiago said, some playmaking ability. But being able to step into like wide open three-pointers with time and space as – you know, you see slower-footed defenders retreat has really helped Paul Reed kind of find that rhythm with the Delaware Bluecoats this season. You see him be very dangerous attacking closeouts. He can push the ball off the defensive glass. When we get to the tape, you're going to absolutely love watching this guy run the floor. He's got excellent quickness, length, intensity as an offensive rebounder as well, which that is a huge plus for Doc Rivers. You saw, I think, the game be a little too fast for Paul Reed at times with the Blue Coats, but especially his handle, it looked a little sloppy at times. But watching this guy run the court at that size, really stands out. So on the surface, Paul Reed's three-point shooting was kind of the main ticket this season. 3.6 attempts per game, overall 24-54 from three. He shot 15 of 19 from the free throw line, good for nearly 79%. When you look deeper, though, this guy was much, much more. He finished with a defensive rating of 102.6, a net rating of 6.1, a true shooting percentage of 65.9. He only turned the ball over 2.6 times a game with a 24.6 usage percentage. That's actually the same he had there in his final season at DePaul. You love to see that. When you combine that with his excellent steals and blocks number, this is a really interesting prospect. And most of his damage was done inside the paint with the Blue Coats. 66% of his offense was around the paint area. Nearly 17% was from points off turnovers, something you also love to see. Before I throw it, sorry, I'm ranting. Before I throw it to Justin, look at this guy's season overall. What a phenomenal season from Paul Reed. First in blocks per game, first in efficiency, third in scoring, third among wins in G League and assists per game. Tied for third in steals per game, third in rebounds per game, fifth in points per game, and ninth in blocks per game. He's just all over the stat sheet. Really? Justin, what was your take watching this guy, Paul Reed, man?
Dude, like, just impressive. Like, to be honest with you, I didn't know what to expect from him coming into the G League season. And something that was very impressive to me is that coming into it, the Delaware Bluecoats in general had a smaller lineup than most in the G League. Their tallest guys were about 6'9 to 6'11, and their tallest guy wasn't even on the court most of the time. Paul Reed at 6'9 was playing the center spot for them in the starting lineup and at the end of the game. So it was, to me, it was really impressive to see how him being 6'9 was able to really put his game into the paint. Like, That's really where he was like most of the time. The post moves, the spinning to the rim, even at times, his 3-point shot became such a legitimate shot that people had to come out and guard, that he was able to break down defenders when driving in. Like faking his shot and going right into the paint, he was able to go in there, make some dribbles, get some moves on people, and go and easily score because of that touch that he does have around the rim and because of the threat of the 3-point shot. So it's just he was really impressive. And on the offensive end, I know coming into it, coming into the season, I don't think anybody expected him to be that as good as he was on the offensive end. Not only was he making shots, but he was making them efficiently, especially around the rim. Also, the fact, like you said, his defense. The man almost averaged two steals and two blocks a game. And in the regular season, he was he averaged 1.8 blocks and 1.9 steals. So that was in the 15 games they played for the season. And then in the playoff games, I think they had three playoff games, he had averaged 2.3 blocks and 2.3 steals. That's like, those are some big numbers, man. And I will say, and you'll see them probably, I'm assuming that they're in this highlight reel, but you'll see those steals and blocks aren't only coming in the inside in the paint. It's when he's getting switched out on smaller guards, like 6 foot size guards, and still being able to stay in front of them and still being able to catch those balls in the passing lanes. I think that's something else that was very impressive to me. The fact that he's 6'9", 7 foot wingspan, and still able to be switched out on the smaller guards that are like 5'11", 5'10", and still be successful on them. There's a play that I can remember. I think it was the last game of the season against the Hustle. David Stockton, he's on that team, and he's their point guard, very good point guard for the G League. Been in the G League for a few seasons now, and very small guard. Like, I think he's like 5'10", 5'11". And Paul Reed was able to stay in front of him for a whole 10 seconds of the possession. And then David tried to pull up in the mid range, and Paul was able to block his shot. So it's just like plays like that, where a big 6'9" guy like that, in most cases, has a very, very hard time on a guard that size. So ultimately, I'm just super impressed defensively, but also on the offensive end with the versatility that he was able to bring this season.
That's what you'd love to see. The defensive versatility translated, but you just saw a monumental rise offensively for this guy. Ron says, I love his work ethic. He has a chance to be a great defensive specialist. Offense really improving. Amen, Ron. Amen. Thanks for joining. Let's go into the film. I made that this morning. Just a ton of fun to make. He is a blast to watch, especially at his size. Kind of the main storyline revolving around Paul Reed really was back a couple weeks ago. Shams reported that the NBA plans to remove the 50-game limit on all two-way contracts for the remainder of the season and playoffs. That means it's opening up additional two roster spots on all NBA teams. That means Paul Reed is going to be here, baby, and we're going to be able to see this guy hopefully get some playing time. Justin, what do you expect from Paul Reed moving forward? Do you expect him to get any PT or burn moving forward or in the playoffs? What's your take?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely expect him to get maybe. I don't know about the playoffs, so it really depends. I think ultimately it's going to depend on the moves they make before the trade deadline. If Mike Scott's gone, if players like that are at our 4 or 5 depth spots, like if we lose some centers, if we lose Mike Scott, I could definitely see him getting some chances at the power forward or small ball five role. Because I personally think the small ball five role would be perfect for him. So I could definitely see it. I just don't know, based on the roster construction right now, if he would have a chance to get minutes based on who else is there right now. I think, like I said, it really depends to me who goes in the trade deadline, because ultimately the Sixers are going to make moves. It's just a matter of who and where and what. So yeah. I think that really, to me, depends on what goes on there.
Just watching Paul Reed, you can see a lot of his damage in transition, in the paint. But what I think I found really impressive, look at that defensive play there where he just suffocates. That's, you know, having a guy that size be able to defend on the perimeter and inside the paint is extremely valuable. I mean, this is a positionless league. Your team is only as good as your weakest defender. And when you have a guy like Paul Reed that can switch and defend, in and outside the paint, man, it is so valuable. It's such a premium in today's NBA. But what I love about Paul Reed is he's got a much better first step than I ever thought back at DePaul. Like, you're going to see some plays here where he just takes he's faced up at in that mid-range area, and he just beats his man off the dribble. And that's something I did not expect at all. So him to be that, like, stretch 5, stretch 4, like you said, I don't think – I don't expect him to be a 44% three-point shooter moving forward. Those numbers are definitely going to deflate a little bit when he gets more volume. But there's a lot to like about this guy. He's 21 years old, and I do see his – I don't like that shot. The shot is definitely funky. We just saw that. But I do see the potential. There is a true floor here, a path here for this guy becoming a role player in the NBA.
And I will say, even if he doesn't end up being the offensive weapon that you'd like him to be at that 4-5 spot for the Sixers, I think either way, the amount of value he brings on the defensive end is – it's kind of to me like how Matisse could be. Like and obviously not – Matisse is on a godly level defensively, but when it comes to that 4-5 position, and also just the switching of him, like he's really, to me, from what I've seen, could guard 1-5, like genuinely. And maybe, and obviously he'd have hard time on big men like maybe Joel Embiid, like those kind of guys. But ultimately, with most of the how big most of the centers are in the league now, I could really seeing him be able to guard anybody, and that's obviously something that is always valuable to have on your team.
Ron says, never considered the intangibles like loose balls, hustles, deflections. Do you have stats on read? I didn't find any of that. NBA.com has all those for NBA players, but for G League, yeah. I didn't find the deflection stats that I was looking for. But he definitely had the steal percentage. He definitely had the steals. He was among the tops in the G League in that area. Mm-hmm. Like you said, this is not you know, some zone defender like Matisse. That's just going to be a beast in that area. But he definitely has the wingspan and the feet and the ability to move in and out of the perimeter and paint to defend.
Yeah, and something I want to say to this comment of deflected balls and everything like that, I think he honestly was one of the best in the league that I saw. Like, okay, so I watched every single game of the Bluecoats this year, and from what I saw from Paul Reed, the amount of deflections he did get was pretty ridiculous. Like, the amount he was poking his hands in passing lanes, the amount he was active with his hands was very impressive, and it did remind me a lot of the Ben Simmons, the Matisse Thybulle in the NBA level, especially where he was poking the balls out, like right between the hash mark and the top of the key. Like, that area was where he was getting a lot of those. And that's how he was getting runouts into dunks most of the time too. So to me, it was all around, like I said, just all around defensively, very impressive. He was getting blocks on the inside, getting passing lane steals, dunking on 2 7-footers, like right here. And just, well, like right here, this is exactly what I'm talking about. This play right here this is the hustle, and that's David Stockton, number 13 right there. That was a very those kind of plays happened all season. Like that was almost every game you saw some play like that. So yeah, ultimately just very impressive guy to watch.
Teddy says, what would be a good NBA comparison for Reed? I'll let you do the comparisons because I hate doing comparisons.
I hate comparisons too, and it's tough because like he's not like, if you really think about defensively, like athletic defensive guy, a lot of people go straight to like a Bam. A lot of people go straight to Pascal, but he's not as athletic as those guys. He's not as quick. He's not them. And he's also not Jeremy Grant either. So it's like, it's kind of hard, to put him in a comparison, in my opinion. I feel like he's kind of his own player. Cause he's a great all around defender, but I don't want to give him that. Like you want to say something he could grow to, mm-hmm. I could say if he like the best we can look for, sure, we can go Bam Adebayo and Pascal Siakam, but I don't think that's where I don't think that's his comp right now. I think that's something, if he could become that, awesome. Mm-hmm. But I think that comes with time in the NBA and if he can get minutes, but that, I don't think that's right now.
Yeah, I fully agree. I'm not comparing him to this guy, but I kind of see a similar path as Christian Wood. Christian Wood is a guy, he's not offensively up to Christian Wood's ability, of course, but you look at his path to becoming what he is today. Christian Wood spent time in the G League. He had his first two seasons averaging 3 points, 2 points. Then he had a season in with Milwaukee, 3 points. Then he just like burst on the scene with the New Orleans Pelicans, 17 points a game. I see that kind of similar path for Paul Reed. I think he's going to, his bread and butter is that defensive versatility and his ability to get transition buckets, get points off turnovers. That is what I see. Maybe make a catch and shoot three. That's what I see Paul Reed, a very limited role player over these next few years. But what we've talked about for the last 20 minutes is that refinement of his offensive game has to be one of the biggest surprises for this guy's. We always expected the defense to translate, but offensively, he's definitely got a lot of maybe a higher ceiling than we first expected.
Yeah, and I think the other thing I really want to touch on with him is just his mentality, man. Like, and this to me, this is like the most important thing you can have as a guy who, as he says, coming out the mud. Like he, and this is that's his like slogan is working hard to get your own. And he's like the confidence this guy has in himself is so important, especially in the where he is right now. Like in the G League, trying to carve out minutes in the NBA, trying to make his own. And this, and to me, this, I want to bring something on the screen.
Yeah, I'll take this down.
Yeah. I got to real quick. The mindset that you need to have. And this is a quote that I got from him in a post game. I believe this was one of the last games of the season in the regular season. He said, I asked him basically how he led the G League in double doubles per game for the whole G League season with 11. And I asked him like, how does it feel to be in your first year as a pro, in your first year in the G League and leading the league in so many statistical categories? And he basically just said, I'm supposed to be doing this. If I wasn't leading the G League right now, for me, it'd be a problem. I got plans on leading the NBA. So I'm supposed to be doing this. Like, awesome. That kind of mindset you can't beat, and that's what you need to be successful, not only in the G League, but to get out of the G League and then be successful in the NBA. And those are the kind of people you want. And I just based on his mindset and with how good he already is, in my opinion, makes me think he does have a chance to make it out of the G League and be good in the NBA.
Well said. Could not agree more. That is a phenomenal quote. From Paul Reed. Ron says, if he bulks up, watch out. Envisioning him next to Embiid, Ben Simmons, Matisse Thybulle in late game situations. A lot to look forward to. Definitely a prospect all Sixers fans need to keep an eye out for moving forward. Let's wrap it up, Justin. Where can we find you? What do you got going on, man?
Yeah, I mean, right now, Blue Coat season's over, so a little bit more focused on the Sixers at the moment. So we'll be doing a post-game show later tonight, and hopefully we'll be trying to do a little more consistently lately. We've all been pretty busy with a lot of other projects going on. I'm in college. He's got a job.
What? He's got a job.
So we're busy people. So obviously we'll try to get that content out as much as possible with the post-game shows. I know we'll have one tonight for the game versus the Spurs. Ben Simmons is looking like he's going to play. So thank God we get to see one of our stars out there. hopefully Joel gets back soon, is healthy. I want him to stay out as long as he can. So he is healthy personally, but hopefully we see that soon. If you do not already, follow me on Twitter right here at @J_Persichetti. Anything Blue Coats, I'll be out. That'll be on there. Anything Sixers, usually Eagles, Phillies, like really anything, just go follow that. For any updates.
Ron says, great job, guys. Wish Maxie got some time with the Blue Coats. He would have been so terrific.
Oh, yeah.
There, man. In the bubble, like just watching the pace and space of Connor Johnson's system down there, like Maxie would have just
he would have thrived in the system. And real quick before we get off that off this topic completely, I actually thought there was a chance that they may have sent Maxie down during the All-Star break. Yeah. When they sent Isaiah Joe down, I was kind of surprised that they didn't send Maxie down too, because neither, like, he wasn't getting a lot of minutes either. But because Shake has been hurt every once in a while, it kind of didn't surprise me. I was like, they probably want to make sure just in case that they have another guard who can handle the ball. But it did suck because I thought getting minutes down there for him would have been amazing.
Yeah, he would have put up monster numbers down there for sure.
It'd been Shake Milton type numbers for sure.
All right. Party on Broadwise, last Thursday, we had a podcast with Mark Schofield. We broke down Jalen Hurts and the NFL draft. What should we expect from Jalen Hurts moving forward? Is he worth building around? Make sure you go check that out. This coming Tuesday, we are going to be doing a live first round mock draft with all the teams. That's going to be a lot of fun. We are full blown draft season right now. And then we move on to the NBA draft. So this is how we roll here typically. Party on Broad is essentially a player development podcast. I don't know if you ever realized that, but that's my bread and butter. That's my heart and soul. It runs through my veins. Yeah. Make sure you like, comment, subscribe here at The Painted Lines. Check us out on Twitter at The Painted Lines. Check us out on Twitch, Facebook, Instagram.
We'll everywhere, baby. We everywhere. go look up The Painted Lines on any app and you'll find us.
Yep.
Yeah.
Follow my man Justin on Twitter at J_Persicetti. For Justin, for myself, stay awesome, guys. See you next time.
Peace.
And the Sixers win it! Wow!
Oh, man. Embiid just posterized Russell Westbrook.
You love the